don't get it right. Where I talk a talk that I don't walk and miss the moments right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. There's no denying I have changed. I've been saved from who I used to be. But even at my best, I must confess I still need help to see the way you see. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped. Somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith, a little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me.
Good morning, everyone. I don't know if you can't see what, those of you that are online, but we're kind of lopsided this morning. We're kind of one-sided over here. We just have one person over here, but welcome this morning. It's so good to be here this morning. I was just telling Gideon yesterday by text that I miss people. He said, "How are you doing?" I said, "I'm okay, but I really miss people." So it's really good to see people. You know, outside of my own family, I love my children. I love my son, but I'm getting tired of seeing him every day and only him. And he doesn't hug me. So it's, you know, and he's not really friendly, you know. I mean, he is. I shouldn't say he's not. That's bad, eh? Hopefully, sorry, Anthony, if you're watching. But, you know, he really isn't. I know, you guys all know Anthony. You've known him forever. He never smiles. Never smiles. Comes up in the morning. You know, so it's just nice to see people. I can't really see your smiles, but I know you're smiling. So anyway, welcome this morning. I'm so glad that we're here this morning. Let's open this morning in prayer. Father God, we just thank you so much. Thank you for who you are. Thank you that you're here with us this morning. Thank you that you are in each house this morning. Father, for those who are tuning in today, God, we just wait in anticipation of what you have for us today. Lord Jesus, we just honor you. We praise you. We give you all the glory, Lord Jesus. And we welcome you here this morning, Father. Amen. So to start us off this morning, we're going to have Lois Hetherington. She's going to bring the announcements and the call to worship, and she's got some friends who are going to also make some announcements to us this morning. Let's hear what they have to say.
Good morning and welcome to our service. Here are the announcements for the coming week. We're still gathering in person at 15% of capacity following the regulations under Step 1 of the Provincial Reopening Ontario Plan. We expect the current steps will last at least another week or so. We will keep you in the loop with any changes. If you are interested in joining us in person, please go to bookwhen.com/SUEFMC and pre-register for each week you will attend, as we need this to maintain our capacity and for contact tracing. Aside from that, please keep praying for an end to the effects of COVID-19. We'll let you know as soon as we're able to increase our capacity. A couple of things to highlight that have been made available. Firstly, the ministry reports for the past year have been sent out through your email. These are the reports that each ministry leader prepares for each year's annual society meeting. They give an overview of what each ministry has been up to through the years. This year, we didn't hold a regular society meeting due to COVID and our focus on the life plan framing our future session. However, your ministry leaders have still made this available, so you can be in the loop. Check it out when you can. Secondly, an updated church directory is now available. Please contact the office if you need to pick one up, and arrangements can be made. There's an important fundraising event coming up to support a valuable ministry in our community. This year's Teen Challenge Golf Classic is coming up quickly. It'll be at Crimson Ridge Golf Course on Thursday, July 8th. For more info, you can contact Teen Challenge Northern Ontario Men's Centre or visit their website at tcnorth.ca. A few items for our church over the summer. Be sure you get a chance to read the Framing Our Future report from our Life Plan team that was emailed out a while back. Instead of the usual hiatus from board meetings, Pastor Christopher and the board will be doing some focus meetings throughout the summer to work together to find the best action steps for the items highlighted. Please continue to pray into the best steps to take. We're also working on an additional way to get together. In light of the nice weather and the reopening Ontario plan options for outdoor services, we are opening up a second outdoor service starting in July. It will be a condensed service running from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. every second Sunday starting on July 11th. Bring your own chair so there will be enough seating for everybody outdoors. Lastly, as you may know, our youth ministry is in the midst of a transition this summer. Please join the staff and board in praying and pursuing the Holy Spirit's lead in what our youth ministry is to look like in this session and moving forward. There are some fun plans in the works for our youth and kidmin over the next couple of months. And with more on that, here's our kidmin pastor, Liz.
Hey, good morning. As you know, All Tribes Christian Camp is near and dear to our hearts. It's a camp that we love and we support. And so this year they get to run some in-person camps. Aren't you so excited for this? Okay, so they're going to obviously follow COVID rules, and these things are always changing, but they've got a pretty good setup. So this year they're running two separate weeks of camp for VBS. And these VBS camps run for kindergarten to grade 8. And then they're also running a rock camp, and that one is for high school kids, grade 9 to 12. And so here's where you come in. There's an opportunity for us to send some kids to camp. Okay, so if this is something that's on your heart and you'd like to donate towards this particular initiative, all you have to do is your normal offering giving. If you do it through an envelope, just mark on there All Tribes, and Roxanne will be sure to get it in that particular fund. If you e-transfer, there's an option for you to put a little message on the bottom. Make sure that you mark it All Tribes, and again, she'll make sure it gets into this particular fund. We want to make sure that many kids get to go to camp. We want to make sure that All Tribes is supported. And also, guess what? We're going to do a youth and kids event in August. So stay tuned for more information about that. But from this fund, we'd also like to send some kids out for this particular event where we get to try out their high ropes course and just have a great day together on the grounds. Okay, so there's more information about that coming. Stay tuned for that. But in the meantime, Dave Kreitzweiser is up next. He serves us so well in our church, but did you know he also serves the national team? So not only is he our delegate, but he's also the board chair for the BOA of FMCIC. And so I just want to take the time to say thanks, Dave, for all of that. And he's going to share with us some quick updates from our recent general conference. Up next.
Hi, good morning. Hey, yeah, I know what you're thinking. This guy again? Well, but this time I'm here as your delegate. I'm going to bring you a couple of update things. Greetings from my shack, my backyard cabin. Some things going on with your National Board of Administration, the BOA, so I thought this would be a good time just to bring you up to date in terms of some of the initiatives that are going on. I'm going to be talking about four fairly major initiatives that are underway, and I'll be doing it in two parts. So this is part one. So here we go. So about 4 years ago, our newly created intercultural engagement team, along with the bishop, started our Free Methodist Church in Canada on a pathway toward improved friendship and reconciliation with Indigenous peoples in our communities. And this applies to all of our churches, whether we have direct connections to First Nations or not, because this is something that we as a denomination, as a movement, believe that we are prompted to do. And so to that end, our denomination recently announced a repudiation of the doctrine of discovery. This was something that the Truth and Reconciliation Commission recommended for all Christian churches a few years ago, and our denomination has just done that now. The doctrine of discovery was an edict or a decree that was pronounced by the Christian Church back in the 1400s, actually, that gave all of the European explorers the right to claim all non-European inhabited lands as their own, as some kind of a God-given right. And that more or less general mindset of European-based entitlement has persisted in various forms up to these modern times. And so we now publicly proclaim it as false doctrine. And as a further step toward improved relations with Indigenous groups, the Free Methodist Church in Canada is also recommending that local churches officially adopt and announce a land acknowledgement statement. This is simply an official statement declaring that we recognize that the land that we live, work, play, and worship on is traditional territory of First Nations people. So your local board is working on that in these days, and be back to you on that in the coming weeks. So the second initiative that I just wanted to bring you up to date on and like to highlight is our denominational efforts at reviewing women in leadership across our denomination. Now, from its inception, the Free Methodist Church has been among the leaders in Christian North American churches to appreciate, support, and promote women in upper leadership roles. But we find that there are still some hesitations and barriers to women in our denomination that are following a calling into some sort of upper leadership roles. And so we've established a working group to begin to work on that. A working group has been put in place to help us find ways of improving opportunities for women in leadership. Okay, good. Those are the two things I wanted to bring to your attention. See how much fun that was. So I'll see you again for part two. Over and out.
Our call to worship this morning is taken from Psalms 130, verses 1 to 8 from the NIV. Out of the depths I cry for you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, keep a record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, so that we can with reverence serve you. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits. In his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He will redeem Israel from all their sins. Amen.
So just this morning, let's stand together and let's worship this morning. God, we just praise you and we thank you, Lord Jesus. And that is what we want to do this morning, Father. We want to worship you. We want to worship your name, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Amen. Seek you this morning, Lord Jesus. Blessed be your name, Father in heaven. Blessed be your name. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. You may be seated. This morning, I'd like to just welcome the message this morning from Thomas Henschel. He's going to be speaking to us this morning about practical prayer. So let's sit back and enjoy what God has to say through Thomas Henschel.
Nice to be here again. And I was getting ready earlier this morning, and Claire saw me, you know, leaving early. She's like, "Oh, why can't I go with you? Oh, I have to be at church earlier." "Well, why is that?" "Oh, because I'm giving the message." "Children's church?" And I said, "No." And she's like, "Oh, okay." So really, you don't actually have to attend this sermon, because apparently there's already a book that just tells you everything you need to know. So we could just skip right ahead. And just going off of what Lane talked about last week about abiding, prayer is a great way for abiding in Christ. And I'm going to be talking about prayer, and I am doing that as a student, as this is something that I struggle with, and so I am done research and worked on this in my own life, and I'm here to share with you the things that I have found helpful, and I hope that they are helpful to you as well. There are definitely things that I wish I knew, right? So I guess once again, I'm doing a sermon to kind of 16-year-old me, things I wish I knew about prayer. Even though it's called practical prayer, I won't be going into things like body position or scents and candles and in the bulletin I put in the ACTS framework, which I found to be a helpful framework, but there's lots of different ways that you can do that. I think it's the most important thing is to think about prayer correctly, and then the practices of prayer will flow from that, and so that's what I'm going to be going to. And finally, I'm going to be throwing about 100 things at you, and so you can't possibly keep notes on all those things, but my hope is, by doing such a scattershot type sermon, is that there would be 1, 2, 3 things that would really resonate and you would be able to take away from this. So that's my approach. I will be doing scripture verses from The Message, and I don't know if you're familiar with that particular translation. It is done by one guy, and the thing that I like about it is that he is a poet and a musician, and so his translation, I feel, gets back to more the original oomph of scripture, because when you look at NIV, ESV, or whatever edition, that's done by scholars, and you know what they're good at writing at? Textbooks. So the Bible reads like a textbook, and I found The Message to just kind of give that punch back to it. So that's why I'm doing that. Prayer is a universal cry of the human heart. Every faith has some kind of prayer. Remote tribes present offerings and then pray for everyday things like health and food and rain, victory in battles. The Incas and Aztecs even went so far as human sacrifice to really get their God's attention. And 5 times a day, modern Muslims will just stop whatever they're doing and answer that call of prayer. If you're praying, I want to be clear, you're already doing it right. So this is not about like bad and good. This is about hopefully good, better, and best. And so I kind of think of it like a foot wash or a foot rub, okay? Any foot rub is better than no foot rub. Can I get an amen, ladies? So that's really what we're trying to do here. Jesus was at the temple and watching 2 guys pray. One was a Pharisee, one was a publican or a tax collector or somewhere in the government. And the only thing I want to take from that right now is that Jesus said, hey, that guy's doing it right and that guy's doing it wrong. It doesn't mean the guy who's doing it wrong can't change, but he definitely said, hey, there's a difference between these things. And so I'm really going to run from that. This is Jonathan Aiken, and he's a former MP in Great Britain. And you're like, okay, who cares what he has to think? Well, I'll tell you in a second. He compares his early relationship with God to that of a bank manager. I spoke to him politely, visited his premises intermittently, occasionally asked him for a small favor or overdraft to get myself out of difficulty, thanked him condescendingly for his assistance, kept up the appearance of being one of his reasonably reliable customers, and maintained superficial contact with him on the grounds that one of these days he might come in useful. When he was convicted of perjury and sentenced to prison, he decided to pursue a more personal relationship with God. So I don't know about you, but prayer is one of those really mysterious, weird things that, I kind of struggle with. So these are some common questions that have come out. The publisher of Yancey's book did a poll on their website, and they said, do you feel satisfied with the time you're spending in prayer? Only 3.5% said yes. So, wow. Why should God care about me? If God knows everything, then really, what's the point? Why do answers seem so inconsistent and even capricious? Does a person with many friends praying stand a better chance of healing than one with few? Why does God sometimes seem close and sometimes far away? Many people experience prayer more as burden than as pleasure. And they can even feel guilty and start blaming themselves. Catherine's recently taken a course, and they talked about your spiritual life and your physical body and the intersection of those. And I found it interesting that quick prayers on a brain scan don't register at all. But if you do 12 minutes of prayer, they can actually see it on the brain scan. And if you do that for 8 weeks, 12 minutes of prayer every day for 8 weeks, they can actually see changes occur within your brain. A couple of them are, it strengthens the area of social interaction, increasing compassion, and making us more sensitive to others. It reduces stress and lowers blood pressure. Those are good things. Strengthens the part that helps us override emotional and irrational urges. More thoughtful, more rational. And I listen to Harvard Business Review's podcast as a regular thing, just keep in touch with management theory and such. And they actually had an episode where they talked about secular prayer. Now, they didn't actually use the word prayer, but that's essentially what they were talking about. They were talking about some form of meditation. And they were talking about all these great physical benefits, all these great benefits to your workforce, if you were to institute some kind of 10 or 12 minute meditation at the beginning of each day. I just found that fascinating, that we eject God, and then we find out, actually, there's good things about the things he asked us to do. So let's just bring those good things back and still keep him away. So in James 1, he says, if you don't know what you're doing, and this is me right here. If you don't know what you're doing, pray to the Father. He loves to help. You'll get his help and won't be condescended to when you ask for it. Ask boldly, believingly, and without a second thought. Okay, so if that's what we're supposed to do, how can we pray? Oops, I went too fast on that. Okay, so we're going to dig into it. And it's kind of like I want to have a great marriage, but I don't really want to put a lot of effort into it. Those things don't really go together. So there is some discipline and some thinking that goes along with this. So the first thing is I want to talk about being concrete versus abstract. Is it important to you to know if your prayers are being answered? Well, then they have to be specific enough for you to be able to tell that they've been answered, right? So a good practice, obviously you've heard this, is to write them down. And I have found, as I have written down my prayers and I check back on them, actually way more of them have been answered than I thought. You know, just my general feeling of like, I don't know, I'm shooting 50-50 here. But actually it's like a lot better than that. So that's pretty interesting. I've been in a number of small groups that have, you know, prayer time at the end, and I'm not talking about any particular group in this case, but let's just take a look at some of the generic prayers that I've heard in a small group Bible study. Lord, I want to have a good week. I want to be a better person. I want to lose weight. Now, let's just take a minute and let's look at some of the prayers in Scripture. We're going to look at one. We're going to look at a bunch of them, but let's look at this one. So the setup here is Abraham, he's about to die, and he's really worried about his son Isaac, you know, who he waited a long, long time for, and then he almost killed, but he didn't kill, and now he's like, oh man, he's going to inherit all my stuff, he doesn't even have a wife, we need to go get this guy a wife, okay? So the way he did that time was you sent your servant off, and he went and found himself a good wife and brought it back to Isaac. So that's the setup here. So the servant has just been tasked with this thing, and he's like, got to go to this strange town and meet a bunch of strangers and pick one out as a wife. And so he prays, O God, God of my master, Abraham, make things go smoothly this day. Well, that sounds exactly like the generic prayer that I just talked about. Hey, I want to have a good week. But he goes so much further. Treat my master Abraham well as I stand here by the spring while the young women of the town come out to get water. Let the girl to whom I say, lower your jug and give me a drink, and who answers, drink, and let me also water your camels, let her be the woman that you have picked out for your servant Isaac. Then I'll know that you're working graciously behind the scenes of my master. That's like really specific. That he has put a lot of dots on that map that now need to be filled in. It so happened that the words were barely out of his mouth when Rebekah, the daughter of Bethuel, whose mother was Milcah and wife of Nahor, these are awesome names, Abraham's brother, came out with the water jug on her shoulder, and the girl was stunningly beautiful and a pure virgin. She went down to the spring, filled her jug, came back up. The servant ran to meet her and said, please, can I have a sip of water from your jug? So this is the first part he prayed for, his opener. She said, certainly, drink, and she held the jug so that he could drink. When he had satisfied his thirst, she said, I'll get water for your camels too until they've drunk their fill. She promptly emptied her jug into the trough, ran back to the well to fill it, and she kept at it until she had watered all the camels. The man watched silent. Was this God's answer? Had God made his trip a success? I love how human that is. Their words can't describe. You got to use a meme. Total facepalm on that. So the man goes to the house, the camels were unloaded, given straw and feed, water was brought to bathe their feet of the man, the men with him, then Laban brought out food, but the man said, hey, I'm not gonna eat until I tell you the story about like what just happened. Okay, he's so excited about this direct answer to the specific prayer that he won't even eat. He's gotta share it with you. So it gives a means for witness, right? When our prayers are real specific and we hear God answering them. So how can we go back to these generic prayers? I mean, there's a lot of ways, obviously, you can go with this, but these are some examples. Okay, so have a good week. That can turn into wisdom to see the best that I can do and not the expedient or the easy. And that might even sound a little generic to you, but I'm thinking if I prayed that, I would be able to look back at last week and go, yeah, you know, that was a moment where I was going to do this, but I actually did this other thing and it worked out way better. And that is very concrete, and I could tie back to that prayer. To be a better person, when anger arises, to have the strength to choose peace. That's hard, right? And especially if you're struggling with anger outbursts and such, you have probably a very weak muscle in that respect, right? And you need it strengthened in order to deal with that. And finally, to lose weight, when temptation or sadness strikes, which are certainly triggers for me to go and eat something, that joy can be found in Jesus and not in Doritos, despite how good they are. Okay, the second is to acknowledge helplessness. Your prayers don't have to be eloquent, and sometimes they can be too long and wordy. You aren't a lawyer who's being paid by the hour, and you aren't a writer being paid by the word. So in some circumstances, you just need to get right down to it. And so I love this one with Peter in Matthew 14. He's jumping out of the boat. Peter walked in the water of Jesus, but when he looked down at the waves churning beneath his feet, he lost his nerve, started to sink, and he cried, Master, save me! Awesome prayer. There it is, beginning to end. Jesus didn't hesitate. He reached down, grabbed his hand. Done. Next is laying it all on the line. And so let's take a look at a verse first, and then I'll kind of unpack that more. So Ahab is this really lousy king of Israel, and Elijah just shows up out of nowhere. Now, if you look at your Old Testament prophets, you'll see they give a little bit of bio. They'll say so-and-so came from such a place. For instance, I'm thinking of Amos. When he writes about it, he tells you, oh, I'm from a farming town, and I used to do this and whatever, and God gave me this message, and I came, and I gave it to you. That's not how Elijah starts out. This is how Elijah starts out. And then this happened. Elijah the Tishbite from among the settlers of Gilead confronted Ahab. Some dude just walked up to the king and said, as surely as God lives, the God of Israel, before whom I stand in obedient service, the next years are going to see a total drought, not a drop of dew or rain, unless I say otherwise. That's very different from your Old Testament prophets who say, the Lord says, blah, 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 blah. It seems to me that Elijah's doing this on his own volition. Now, this is definitely an argument from silence, but I think that God's like waiting around for somebody to really stick their finger in the king's face, and Elijah's just the guy who did it. And that is what qualifies Elijah to be Elijah. Then, after this, God speaks to Elijah. God then told Elijah, you better get a dodge. Okay? Now, we get a little bit more of this picture in James. So in James 5, he says, Elijah, for instance, human just like us, prayed hard that it wouldn't rain, and it didn't. Not a drop for 3.5 years. Then he prayed that it would rain, and it did. The showers came, and everything started growing again. So this is very different from, I think, the typical way that I read this passage, where it's like, oh, God told him, like, hey, go say this, and then it doesn't happen. Right? Kind of like the plagues in Egypt. But, like, wow, that's pretty impressive if he just, like, I'm going to lay it on the line, and no rain. Just pulls it out of the air. And God's like, sounds great, let's do that. Okay, so I'm going to show you somebody that prays like that, and his name is George Mueller. He began each day with several hours of prayer, imploring God to meet the practical needs of his orphanage. So he lived in England, and over his lifetime, he cared for 10,024 orphans. At one time, he had 1,722 orphans in five houses, five specially designed homes, not like little houses. He then provided educational opportunities for the orphans to the point that he was even accused of raising the poor above their natural station in British life. He established 117 schools which offered Christian education to more than 120,000 children, all without asking for fundraising ever. Never asked for a cent. He asked the Lord and nobody else. And if God didn't come through, the whole thing fell apart. And God saw him through the whole way through. So that just, that amazes me. Okay, next, praying to know the future. Should we pray to know the future? Is that like a legitimate thing? I know I want to know things about the future. So to set the stage here, Ahab has a grandson, and he's not too bright, okay? He fell off his roof. And I don't know what he was doing in order to fall off his roof, but he fell off his roof and he got hurt. And so he decides, I want to know if I'm going to get better from this, or is this the end? He's probably having a little pity party for himself. So he fell through the balcony railing on the rooftop of his house in Samaria and was injured. So he sent messengers off to consult Baal-zebub, the god of Ekron. Am I going to recover from this accident? But God's angel spoke to Elijah, the Tishbite, up on your feet, get out and meet these messengers of the king of Samaria with this word. Is it because there's no God in Israel that you're running off to consult Baal-zebub, god of Ekron? Here's a message from the God that you've tried to bypass. You're not going to get out of that bed you're in. You're as good as dead already. So Elijah delivered the message and was gone. Once again, Elijah gets out of Dodge. Now, what I really like when I read this, just in my own personal study, I was like, God never chastised him for wanting to know about the future, for wanting to know if he was going to get better. That's not the problem. The problem is where he went to get those answers. And so that is something that has become very personal for me. I was going through some real business struggles about where should this business go in the future, what is my role within it. For those that don't know, I'm self-employed. I have a company down in Burlington. And this is going back about to 2010. And I was really struggling with, what is the future of this company? And so I read this thing about the king asking about the future, and I was like, can I ask about the future? Is that okay? Like, is there some kind of platform I can stand on? Hey, God, like, I want to know about the future and expect an answer on that. And so I had a vision that I was really unclear if this was like my imagination or if this was actually a vision, because I was teleported to the future and I saw some things and I saw some people I didn't even know and such. And so I was like, man, what is all going on here? And so I remember praying, Lord, this is privately by myself. I was like, Lord, I've seen these things in the future with my own eyes. I just want to know, is it true? Is it real? I just need that confirmation. And so I have a friend who was a monk, and that seemed like a pretty good person to me. And so I said, hey, monk man, can you come and pray with me about this like serious thing that I'm talking about? And he was like, yeah, sure. So he came down to my office, and he sat across the desk from me. And usually when you get those, somebody comes to pray for you, usually want to know, like, what am I praying for? Like, just give me the gist of it, right? And we'll dive right in. And he was about to do that. He's like, so, and he's like, forget it. Let's just pray. So he just came around and put his hand on me, and he just started praying. And I remember the moment when he said, Lord, I feel like whatever, when Abraham was up on the mountains and looking at the land, and you said, hey, Abraham, what your eyes have seen, that I will give you, that is the answer to Thomas's prayer. What your eyes have seen, that I will give you. I'm like, wow, that's incredible. So now I know you can pray about the future and God will give you an answer about that. That also leads into, I felt very prompted to reach out to this particular person. His name's Tim. I felt prompted to reach out to Tim to pray for me. And so that's a point that I want to make. Sometimes God will direct you to others to pray specifically for you. And you're like, well, why can't I do it myself? I'll go in my prayer closet and I'll light a candle and I'll do that, right? I don't know. I don't know why that is, but you just get prompted for it. So a couple years ago, Catherine and I were having a bit of a financial crisis with some of our business things that were going on. And we really needed a mortgage. We like really needed a mortgage. Or things were really going to fall apart, and like a domino effect. And so we had been working on and praying for this mortgage for 6 months, and we were like so close to approval with one bank, and then they're like, I'm not sure I can put this through, and then we have to start with another bank. And it was just going on. It was driving us crazy. And so we came to the prayer time here on Wednesday nights, and I just felt really prompted that Carolyn needed to pray for this one issue. I didn't even know Carolyn very well. I think it was like our third or fourth week here. And it was like, no, Carolyn needs to pray for this. So I went to Carolyn and said, hey, can you pray about this mortgage thing? She's like, sure. So she prayed about it, and we got approval that week. And that meant all the world to us. So if you're praying for mortgages, go to Carolyn. Okay. So next, going back to Jesus looking at the publican and the Pharisee, it's really important about authenticity, okay? So Jesus commented, this tax man, not the other, went home, made right with God. If you walk around with your nose in the air, you're going to end up flat on your face. But if you're content to simply be yourself, you will become more than yourself. So what is the ancient word for hypocrite? We translate it into hypocrite, but there's like a second meaning. Does anybody know or remember what it is? You can just shout it out. Good, I stumped you all. Actor. Yeah. Actor.
I knew that, but I wasn't going to say it.
Well, you're shy. We all know that about you. So I personally find the word actor to be more helpful because Jesus is saying, don't act when you're praying. Just be true and authentic. And that makes a lot of sense. I mean, if he already knows everything in you and what's going on, hairs on your head that are coming out of mine, then, you know, obviously there's nothing you can act on. And so I'm sure that you have seen this and maybe be guilty of it as well. It's just something I want to raise. You can often tell when someone's praying because they put on a prayer voice, right? Like, I think some people who have been around me praying think that I'm actually not doing it quite right because I don't have a prayer voice. I talk to God like he's like standing like right there, and sometimes I joke with him and stuff. And they're like, how can you do that? That's not, you know, honorable and holy and prayer time and stuff. But it's because I don't want to have the prayer voice and kind of put that on and such. And so that's kind of my way of doing that. So it's just something to kind of think of. You know, check yourself, see if you're falling into ruts. You know, one common one can be saying, oh Lord, you know, kind of like every sentence. Like, you would never talk to your wife that way or to a friend or on the phone or something like that. And it's not bad. I actually went through some of the prayers in Scripture, and they do have that because it's kind of a deferential thing about talking to a king or something like that, right? So I'm not saying it's all bad, but just check yourself in terms of ruts. So I have a friend that kind of threw me off when I was praying with him. He says, King Daddy. King Daddy, I would like this. King Daddy, let your glory shine and stuff. I'm like, wow, that's cool. I have never heard that before. That's of his own design. So Philip Yancey says, I often worry about whether or not I sense the presence of God. I give little thought to whether God senses the presence of me. Okay, unprayables. That's a term that I just coined for this message. Do I trust God with my naked self? Now we're really getting in the good stuff. Prayer allows a place for me to bring my doubts and complaints. to God. C.S. Lewis says, we must lay before him what is in us, not what ought to be in us. Yancey says, my image of God, more than anything else, determines my degree of honesty in prayer. Do I trust God with my naked self? Foolishly, I hide myself in fear that God will be displeased, though in fact, the hiding may be what displeases God most. So Philippians 4, Paul says, do not be anxious or worried about anything, but in everything, every circumstance and situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, continue to make your specific requests known to God. This is from the Amplified Version. I find the Amplified really kind of helps get at the meat of it. So the real question here is, does everything mean everything, or is God just acting? So I had a vice. And I'm not going to tell you what it is, but I'm going to say that it was big money poker games. So I loved me some big money poker games. And if there was a big money poker game going on, boy, was I ever going to be there. And I was reading through Yancey's book on prayer, and it just really struck me that I have prayed that I would stop liking big money poker games, or that maybe I would not be around them anymore, or have friends that went to them or something like that. But Yancey said something really interesting, and that is, as I learn to give voice to my secrets, mysteriously the power they hold over me melts away. And so using the big money poker game, I could say, you know what, Lord, I'm just gonna level with you. I love me some big money poker games. You know what I love? I love getting that big pot full of money. And when I get that money, I feel so good. It makes me feel like a big man. And I know I'm better than all the other people around the table. And boy, I love that feeling. If you're praying like that, when I have prayed like that, that's what Yancey's talking about. Suddenly, the grip that it has on you just starts to loosen and starts to melt away. And as I pray that way, then I start to find, you know what? I want to feel important, but actually, Lord, you tell me that I am already important. And actually, that's really bad of me to try and substitute your importance with this other importance. And it just kind of starts to flow from there. And so it's something, like I said, has been really impactful to me. I hope that this is impactful for you. Whatever it is that you maybe you're struggling with, maybe for a long time or whatever, tell God how much you love it. Tell him what's so good about, you know, say gossip or something. It's like, boy, I feel important when I get that juicy bit of gossip and get to share it with somebody. Like, whatever it is, just lay it all out with him.
Thank you for that message. We can always learn how to pray better and how God will respond as we give a voice to those things that really are on our minds and our hearts. So we give thanks for that. Let's stand as we worship one more time.
I am.
Father in heaven, we just give you all the thanks and the praise for who you are. You are such a good, good Father, Lord Jesus. And as we leave this place, Father, today, I just pray, Lord Jesus, that each life would be touched in the way they need it to be, God. That is my prayer, Father, for each and every person here, for each and every person who's attended this service, Lord Jesus, out there, God. We know that you are so good. You're good to us, Lord Jesus. And Father, I just pray that each and every one would have a really good week, Lord Jesus. These things we ask in your name. And Father, as our pastor is away this week, I would just pray that he would have a good, refreshing time, Lord Jesus, him and Sansre. Bring them back to us, Lord Jesus, in good spirits and in good health. Thank you, God. Amen. Have a wonderful week.